Coming up next, Rated K, for kids by kids.
What do you get when you take a dorky android, a flying chimp, and Michael J. Fox stripping in an elevator, put them in the only movie review show just for kids, and invite Siskel and Ebert along for the ride? Find out right here on Rated K,
for kids by kids.
Hey, what's up? I'm Matt Nespole.
And I'm Rebecca Schwager.
And I'm Mark Shanahan. Welcome to Rated K, for kids, by kids, the only movie review show just for kids. And today is like the most incredible show yet because we have two, the big daddies of movie reviews, the kings of movie reviews, Siskel and Ebert on our show. This is terrific.
Yeah, this is
And
great.
You know, before we started, I was just wondering, since we've never had any adults on the show, what should we call you? Like Mr. Siskel and Mr. Ebert?
Mr. Siskel, sir.
No. Mr. Siskel, sir? Okay, I'll call you,
you can
sir.
Just, you can just call me Roger. That'll be just fine.
Jeez. You got that first name.
Okay. Wow, I thought it was
the show
just
is for kids only, so I think I should probably sound like one. He does that all the time. It's not hard for him.
Try cracking your voice a little bit. No, Gene will be fine.
Well, what we're going to do today is take a look at a whole bunch of movies that have come out this spring, and we're going to see how our opinions differ, us being the kids and you guys being the adults. And the first movie we're going to take a look at is Making Mr. Right. All right, on this one, you gave it one thumbs up and one thumbs down, and we gave it an S for sicko and an R for reject. It's all about this single professional woman named Frankie, who's hired to help a billion-dollar android named Ulysses to improve his public image. You see, Ulysses was created by a genius scientist named Dr. Peter. And Dr. Peters is unbelievably brilliant, but socially, he's a total misfit. He's passed everything he knows on to Ulysses, but when it comes to women, that's not much.
I knew it! 1 minute with a woman and he short circuits.
My God, he looks like you!
What did you think he'd look like? An erector set?
So Frankie begins to teach Ulysses how to function with real people. And before you know it, the two of them start to fall in love. And when they start to fall in love, Dr. Peter starts to freak out.
I love you, Jeff. Oh my God! What is that woman teaching you? She is cluttering his progress with useless nonsense. Monopolizing very valuable training time with God knows what. But what? Emotional tics that I have worked to get out of my own personality, she has managed to drum into him overnight. This morning, Ulysses met me in that hall, and he kissed me right near my mouth.
Well, I don't know. I have some problems with this movie. I mean, first of all, the android Ulysses, he's totally annoying. His voice is so annoying throughout the whole movie. And then Frankie had the ugliest hair color I've ever seen. the thing that really bothered me the most about this movie was that at the end, she fell in love with the android. Throughout this whole movie, she loves a machine. It's not right. And, I mean, you love your Cuisinart, but you don't want to marry it or something. But they totally fall in love, and that really made me sick. And I didn't like this movie at all. It wasn't really funny, and they tried a little too hard in certain times.
That's funny. I liked it a lot.
You liked it a lot?
Yeah.
How?
The whole point in her falling in love with the android is not that the android is a machine, but that the android is more human than the human that he's based on. So that was kind of a reverse that I found to be amusing. As for her hair color, what about her in general? I thought she was a terrific actress. Her name is Anne Magnuson. She was pert. She was smart. She was spiffy. She looked like kind of a young Susan Hayward, an actress who made movies many years ago.
Well, I couldn't tell because I was looking at her hair color the whole time.
Well, why weren't you looking at her face? Well, are you a hairdresser or a movie critic?
No, I'd sit there and I'd watch it, and I couldn't tell whether she was doing a good job or not because I'd be going, ooh, look at that hair.
Well, I think that, actually, you should probably have broadened out your scope a little bit and looked a little bit more at the rest of her.
Okay, look. Oh, sorry.
Oh, sorry, but
you go.
Now, that sounds like our show. What bothered me most of all is it's basically a three-character play. You have the scientist, the android, and the woman. Mm-hmm. And to me, the most interesting person was the woman, played by Anne Magnuson, and an interesting performance playing opposite two dullards. Both the scientists, to me, and the android were dull as can be. They were not interesting people. I did not care
what did
for...
You?
One second. I did not care. I did not care. I'm talking to them. You can talk to them anyway.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm talking with them. I did not care for any of the relationships that she had because both guys, she deserved two better guys.
Well, you know, obviously we don't really agree, but let's see what we think of the next movie, which is Project X. You guys gave it one thumbs down and one thumbs up, and we gave it an M for monkey fun and an F for fly. This one's about an Air Force pilot played by Matthew Broderick, who gets real attached to this incredibly irresistible chip.
This is going to be a whole new experience. I just hope I'm up to it.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, but you're talking about jets and bombers. I've only flown bug smashers.
I've got a lot to learn.
No, not you.
Them.
Indicated airspeed, 330.
It all starts when Broderick is transferred to a new post where he gets the unusual assignment of teaching chimps how to fly. All he knows is that this is part of a top-secret experiment. Anyway, the other new kid on the block is a chimp named Virgil, and the two of them strike up an instant friendship. It turns out that Virgil's not only the star pilot of the experiment, he also can communicate in sign language. All around, he's just an incredible animal and grows to be Broderick's best friend on the base. But then things start to get messy. Broderick finds out that the experiment tests for nuclear warfare, and when these big shots come along for a demonstration, Broderick has to bring Virgil to the deadly radiation chamber.
Garrett, take your pilot down to the flight chamber on the double. Okay, let's hustle. Come on, Garrett, on the double. Go, go. Come on, Garrett, let's not keep them waiting. Garrett!
No.
What?
I'm not gonna do it.
Well, you know, I really like Project X. I mean, first of all, it had an important message about, like, you know, unnecessary experimentation on animals. And, you know, I really like that, because I believe in that, but it didn't, like, drum it into you. It wasn't like, save the seals, you know, really sad, depressing. Sure, there were sad parts, and they were really well done, but the whole thing wasn't, like, down. It had some really funny parts, but the chimpanzees are adorable, and, you know, I just had a good time during it.
My reaction isn't too far different from yours. I didn't recommend the movie. I didn't think it was a particularly great film. I thought, again, and this happens when you don't like a picture, you frequently call it rather predictable. You know which way it's going to go. But I will say that there were charming things. Oddly enough, you want to know what I thought the most charming thing was in the whole film? The close-up of Virgil the chimp.
Yeah. Yeah.
Simply, when you just take that tight shot of his face, it's beautiful. And what that says about animals is enough. That's why I like the picture called Day of the Dolphin. Ultimately, and something I found, that animals photograph quite simply.
I find that, generally speaking, that chimpanzees make for better close-ups than dolphins.
You know, well, you get your dates and I'm married, you know. You're single and I'm married.
Oh, no.
But wait, I find it hard because, like, you didn't have a good time at this?
I said, my review was pretty close to.
I actually enjoyed myself a little bit more than Gene did.
Uh-huh.
This is not a great movie. I think we're all agreed that it's not a great movie.
No, I disagree with you there.
But you know what it was? It was a sweet movie. It was a movie that had a lot of heart.
Yeah.
And Matthew Broderick was very good at working with chimpanzees. You know, W.C. Fields once said he would never appear, or he hated to appear in movies with children, animals, and women with plunging necklines, because then nobody would ever look at him. Now, Broderick here is taking a big chance when he's surrounding himself with these really cute animals, and to be able to act with somebody who, let's face it, is not really acting with you because they have to wait and get the chimp in a separate shot to get just the right expression, takes a certain amount of skill, and I thought he brought a lot of human qualities to it.
I thought he stole the show, really. I thought he was one of the most enjoyable.
I thought Virgil stole the show.
You made Matthew Broderick stay. He'll be so happy.
Virgil stole the show from a chimpanzee.
Well, there were no other major...
Oh, you thought Virgil stole the show?
Yeah, he did. Yeah. Virgil and all the good
girls. I agree.
This movie is very easy to take. I think, you know, isn't that very emotional? And, you know, they could have made these, you know, don't do this to animals kind of movies that could have been very emotional, but they just took it easy, and everybody, you know, little kids and their parents and stuff, could really enjoy it, like, just as a fun movie.
I went with my family, and with my parents and my two brothers and my sister, and we're all different ages, and my parents really liked it, because they, you know, they thought it was very nicely done, really pleasant, fun movie, nice, and my little sister loved it, and I loved it, and my brothers loved it. It's just one of those movies that's perfect to see with your family, because it's really, it's not like... You know, some movies you
I think there are very few films that you can see with your family. Yeah. I must say that that's true, and this would be one of them. But the mere fact that it is pleasant, I think pleasant is about as far as I'll go.
What about the bottom line here? Now, how old is your youngest sibling?
She's nine.
Nine. So we get into the Bambi's mother and Mrs. Jumbo syndrome here. At what age would a kid start really being disturbed by the fact that anybody would want to hurt those cute chimpanzees?
I think everybody would be disturbed by it.
Yeah, but I mean really disturbed, you know.
I think about a four or five year old would really get disturbed. Everybody gets disturbed. I don't think anyone's going to go, you know, walk out of that movie feeling like they've really gone through
it. But don't you think it's a movie for people who like to have a good time, you know? I mean, like, when we went there, older people like clapping, you know, and like,
I don't pay too much attention to the audience when I give my review.
Yeah. I just thought, when you said, like, it being bad, you know, you just
I never said it was bad. I'm sorry.
You talked about it being predictable, but I mean, like, all movies today, about 95% of them are predictable. I mean, even great movies.
95% of the predictable movies are bad. Only about 5% of predictable movies are good.
Well, there were a few good predictable movies.
But you know what I mean. If you stop
I know what you mean. I do understand.
See, when, you know, you guys have been doing this for such a long time, and here we are, and we haven't seen nearly as many movies, so they're not as predictable because we haven't seen as many things like
them. I bet they're pretty predictable. Did you think at the end you're going to see the chimp frying or not, huh?
No, wait, but I was sitting there.
I might have enjoyed it.
Did you think that Matthew Broderick was going to be put in jail and arrested and have his head chopped off by the military?
That's why it's for everyone.
At the end of the movie, I was saying, how are they going to get out of this? I mean, what are they going to do to make this have a happy ending? And I'm glad it had a happy ending.
Well, I thought the ending was...
I'm not suggesting that
it have an unhappy ending.
All right, that's cool.
We're not that far apart of this film.
Guys, we got more stuff to do, and when we get back, we're going to take a look at two other movies, Secret of My Success and The Wild Thing. Okay, guys, who wants to do the Ray K address?
Wait,
what am I asking? I haven't done it in such a long time.
No,
I don't
want to
do
it.
Let me do it. You did it last week.
I did not do it last week.
Something like that.
Rated K, for kids by kids. We'll be back after these messages.
Yo, welcome back to Rated K, for kids by kids. This is a special show. We got Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert here. Roger Ebert, sorry about
Uncle
that.
Uncle Roger.
Uncle Roger and Mr. Gene Sir. But the next movie we're going to take a look at is Wild Thing. All right, in this one, you guys gave it two thumbs down, and we gave it a C for cool and a P for psychotic.
Mommy and Daddy leave you? Mama and Daddy leave you here? Mama and Daddy?
It's all about this little boy who witnesses his hippie parents being brutally murdered by a corrupt cop. But then he gets found by this old deranged bag lady who takes him in and teaches him how to live in the urban jungle. As Wild Thing gets older, he becomes this ghetto legend. He's always mysteriously arriving when the good guy gets in trouble. He'll scale a wall or crash through a window, save the day, and then poof, disappear into thin air. There's only one person who's seen him face to face, a social worker named Jane, who he finally learns to trust.
Leah didn't work for the company. No way, Jose. Blue coats work for the company.
With blue coats. Please. Who taught you to talk like this? Did Leah teach you to talk?
Leah? Stinking bums. Company people yelling at each other. Cousin Louie.
Who's Cousin Louie?
This is Cousin Louie. Picking the zits from the hits, scraping the gold from the mold. 10:30 on your dial, WZLP rocks.
Of course, you listen to the radio.
All right, well, okay, this movie, right, it was not one of the best acting movies I've ever seen, you know. It was
way to go, Matt. You're but on. Keep going.
No. I liked it, and I liked it because the killing in this was, like, the most amazing stuff. This little kid runs around killing, like, pigeons with a rake, and he's got this little thing that he, like, shoots rocks at rats, and, I mean, like, he uses an umbrella to kill some Chinese guy, and this was just the most amazing thing I ever saw. And his eyes are so sick. He, like, walks around handing out pineapples to little kids with these great eyes, you know? And, like, if you're really in an abusive, violent mood and you want to go for a good time with your friends, this is it, I'm telling you.
Now, Matt expression is
fine. Matt, I want to ask you this question. Have you ever in your travels encountered the word hyperbole?
Hyperbole, yeah, some big word.
That would be, for example, an example of the guy killing the rats with an umbrella was the most amazing thing you ever saw. There must have been something you've seen that was more amazing.
Well, in the movie, I thought that was great. I haven't seen killing like this mm-hmm. in such a long time.
And so you thought that was good.
Yeah.
But making love with an android is gross.
Well, I didn't see that
but
movie.
But killing Chinaman with an umbrella is okay.
Yeah, it really is. Uh-huh. I have no
okay,
problem.
So basically, you're just into stimulus, right?
If I'm just
coming
into abuse.
And you like it.
Yeah, uh-huh. Because okay. That's the way. I mean, if I'm having a good time, you know, then it's okay.
Well, then you have more in common with the android than you realize.
Hey.
This movie, nice. It seemed to me, was it wasn't nice. No, but killing
picking up
with
an umbrella
isn't too nice either. Or a squirrel, poor little squirrel.
A little
one
kid
segment
like me.
We're rats. One segment we're wringing our hands over the poor little chimpanzee. The next segment we think it's cool to kill rats.
Yeah, but rats have rabies.
So do chimpanzees.
But he's too cute.
The point with this movie was it had a basically interesting idea of this little kid that grows up wild in the ghetto and turns into a superhero. But mm-hmm. then it turned in the last half of its length. Into just total chase and shootout, just like half of the other movies we've seen. How about developing the plot and the characters? What did you think?
I agree with you in the fact that it was like, what's that month? April or May, comes in like a lion and out like mm-hmm. a lamb, you know. It started out really great. I mean,
I think it might be March.
March?
One of them.
Okay.
But April showers make May flowers.
Okay. I meant March.
That bloom in June.
That's right.
What I'm trying to say is it started out really good, and I really enjoyed the first half because, I mean, it was scary, but it was also exotic, and the way that they did it was neat, how the lights would go out, and you'd be sitting in the theater for 3 seconds or something, you know, wondering what was going to happen, and then it would start again, and that was really neat.
Usually when the lights go out, I know they're coming back on in 3 seconds.
but it was neat, like, how it was differently done in most movies. And another thing that I really liked about it is how it went from different time periods and different places, you know. Mm-hmm. It starts out with this little boy in a van with two hippie parents, mm-hmm. and then he's in, like, this ghetto with these bums and this crazy woman taking care of him, and then he's in a big city, like the
called it the zone.
The zone. And, you know, it was really neat how they skipped.
Well, I agree. I really thought it was a crummy movie, but I'll agree with you that it's an interesting idea. And mm-hmm. there have been other ideas, like Truffaut's movie, The Wild Child, which is about a child that grew up in the wild.
About a beautiful film. I think this, I have to be pretty hard line here. I didn't think this film was at all interesting, at all. I basically didn't think that the superhero that he turns into was particularly super. Right. I guess that's what really bothered me is there's this big build-up. I guess this is what you were saying, Rebecca. There's this big build-up, so finally he's the wild thing. And I'll tell you, I didn't think he was particularly... Yes, he does some wild acts, but that's not really wild. That's just, you know, a plot device. And as a thing, he was a dull thing.
No, he was wild.
I think it's unfair to call him a superhero. Superman is a superhero. Wild thing doesn't sound so super. So I think we should take a look at our next movie, which is Secret of My Success. You guys gave it 2 thumbs down, and we gave it an R for right on and an L for lots of fun.
New York is just like Kansas. Intensified.
What? What's that noise? Is something the matter?
Oh, no. Mom, that's just the TV.
It sounds so real.
It's Miami Vice.
In this one, Michael J. Fox plays a guy from the boonies who's itching to make it big in New York City. His arrival is a little less glamorous than he'd hoped, but he's still sure he can take the business world by storm. Unfortunately, the only job he can find is in the mailroom of a large corporation. But hey, he's not going to let a little thing like that stop him. So he comes up with this scheme to pose as a top executive, and before you know it, he's living a double life.
Hey, come on. Sorry. What a nightmare. I'm all right, though. I'm fine. I'm good.
You okay? You all right?
Don't worry about me. Whoa! Gee, transcribe these notes, will you? There's some things on there I need right away. Oh, take copies of this, copies of this. Did you get those supplies I needed?
Yes, sir.
Good. I'll be back later.
Whoa!
Hey, good morning. Gentlemen?
Good morning.
These elevators are stuck again. I'm sick and tired of these elevators always getting stuck.
Hi, G. You take those to the cleaners?